Good morning. We'll continue.
Good morning, ma'am.
That we left yesterday. We have seen the equation at high pressure and low pressure, right? Van der Waal equation and even the Z factor we have discussed. Here, temperature called as boil temperature is defined. Anyone has idea about this? It is denoted by T suffix B. Any idea? Boil temperature. It is not B-O-I-L. Boil, from the name of the boils, Boyle's law. Any idea? What is boil temperature? Can anyone say, students? What is boil temperature?
The temperature at base ideal gas.
Temperature at which?
Above which liquefaction does not occur?
It is not exactly. Can anyone?
The temperature at which real gas obeys ideal gas.
Very good. Yeah. Boil temperature. What is boil temperature? Temperature at which real gas tends to behave like ideal gas. Right? Is it a high temperature or low temperature? Is it high or low? When does the real gas behave like ideal gas? At high temperature or low temperature? What? Question? Yesterday we have taken the condition, right? When does it deviate from the ideal gas behavior and when a real gas behaves like ideal gas? High temperature or low temperature? It behaves like ideal gas, huh? Real gas, when does real gas behave like ideal gas? High temperature. So boil temperature is also a high temperature. In fact, you can see it is the temperature at which ideal gas, real gas behaves like ideal gas. And this temperature is quite high. In fact, this TB for a given gas is higher than TC. What is TC? Critical temperature. It's critical temperature. Usually TB of a given gas is quite higher than TC, where the gas behaves like ideal gas. The relation of TB is A by R into B, which is related to A, that is the Van der Waal constant, which is related to the force of attraction, and B, which is the another Van der Waal constant related to the volume, and R is the gas constant. As we have seen this boil temperature, there are a few more terms which comes under liquefaction of gases. Let us see the meaning of liquefaction of gases. How to liquefy a gas? Under which condition? How to liquefy a gas? By applying high pressure, low temperature. Good. Apply high pressure and low temperature. Here we get a few more terms, that is critical temperature. Before we have seen boil temperature, this is critical temperature, TC. Any idea about critical temperature, anyone? Anyone? Critical temperature. Meghana, can you define critical temperature? Anyone can answer. Asif? Pandana, Sudipa, Anyone? What is critical temperature? Sudeep?
At high temperature.
It's not clear, Sudeep. The voice is not clear.
It is the highest temperature at which liquefaction of gas occurs.
Yes, very good. It is the maximum temperature at which gas can be liquefied by applying pressure.
It is the highest temperature.
Yes, right. Maximum temperature at which gas can be liquefied by applying pressure. Okay, and one more thing you can say, when we say critical temperature, above this temperature, is it possible to liquefy the gas? Above this temperature, is it possible to liquefy the gas? Or below the temperature? When it is set as maximum temperature, below this temperature, the gas can be liquefied, but not above this temperature. Hence, above critical temperature, a gas cannot be liquefied. Here, we will have some examples. Say, two gases are given, A and B. Critical temperature of the gas A, let me say as 290 Kelvin, and that of gas B is 260 Kelvin. Suppose these are the critical temperature of those two gases. Tell me which among them is first liquefied, easily liquefied, A or B? Here, students, what is your answer? Vandana, I've given two gases with the two different critical temperatures. Which one among them can be easily liquefied?
Nothing is visible, ma'am.
Nothing is visible.
Ma'am, it is not visible, ma'am.
Now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Two gases I have mentioned here, A and B. A has critical temperature 290 Kelvin. B has 260 Kelvin. Can you tell me which is first liquefied among these two at a given condition? A or B?
A.
A? If your answer is A, can you tell me why? Why is so? Okay, let me tell you. See, this critical temperature TC is given by, we have TB relation, right? TB was A by R into B, correct? Whereas TC is given by 8A by 27 times R into B. Both have directly related to A. Both TC and TB, both are directly related to A. What do you mean by that? A stands for a constant which relates force of attraction between the molecules, right? A is the constant, van der Waals constant, which relates force of attraction between the molecules. Higher the value of A, higher is the van der Waals force, so easier is the liquefaction. When the gases get liquefied, when the van der Waals force between the molecule increases, so that molecules come close to each other, attractive force increases, the gas gets liquefied, correct? In both cases, TB and TC, both are directly proportional to attractive force, A, isn't it? So if A is higher, liquefaction is easier. Yesterday we have said, higher the A, easier is the liquefaction. Then what about TB or TC? Higher the TC, liquefaction, right? Easier is the liquefaction because TC is directly proportional to, TC is directly proportional to A, which is proportional to what? Force of attraction. A is proportional to force of attraction, which is proportional to liquefaction, right? Isn't it? which is proportional to liquefaction. So in general, we can say higher the TC, higher is the probability of getting liquefaction, or easier is the liquefaction. Hence, among A and B, which gets easily liquefied? It's very clear now. It is A. Hence, by knowing the value of A and by knowing the value of TC, you can define or you can decide which gas can be easily liquefied. Easily liquefiable gas has high TC and even high A. Okay. In order to get the logic answer for this, you just imagine a case where two gases A and B are given with its TC 290 and 260 Kelvin each. You are starting decreasing the temperature. Now you are at room temperature, 298 Kelvin. Assume the room temperature is 298 Kelvin. In order to liquefy the gas, you have to apply pressure, decrease temperature, right? Isn't it? Liquefaction is possible by applying pressure, decreasing the temperature. You start applying the pressure to the gas which has that much TC, correct? From 98 Kelvin, from 298 Kelvin, what should be the temperature now? To be decreased. You keep decreasing the temperature, increasing the pressure. Okay. Now, your temperature has reached from 298 to 290 Kelvin. What would happen? You are decreasing the temperature, applying the pressure. Temperature has reached 290 Kelvin. What would happen? The gas A liquefies, right? Because its TC is 290. What about gas B at 290 Kelvin? It is still gas. Still decrease the temperature, apply the pressure. Temperature becomes 280 Kelvin. What is the condition of these two gases? 280 Kelvin. A is liquid. B is gas. 270 Kelvin. A is liquid. B is gas. 260 Kelvin. Now B also has turned into liquid. Understood. This is how higher the TC, that is critical temperature, faster is the liquefaction. Hence, when two or more gases are given, in order to compare their ease of liquefaction, you can apply this knowledge. The relation of TB and TC are as such. From here, can you say TB and TC, which is greater? From that relation, TB and TC, which is greater? TB is greater, no? 8 by 27, it is less than 1. Whereas TB has 1 into A by RB. Here, 8 by 27 into A by RB, which is greater? TB is greater. So always, TB is greater than TC for a given gas. So much clear? That is regarding the critical temperature, critical pressure. There is another term called as critical pressure. What is critical pressure, anyone? Define critical pressure, anyone? Which is given by P suffix C. Critical pressure, students. Anyone define critical pressure? Yeah, Darshan. Maximum pressure. By which? It should be a minimum pressure, right? Temperature, critical temperature is the maximum temperature, whereas critical pressure is a minimum pressure. If you apply more than that, it's possible to liquefy, but less than that is not possible. So it is a minimum pressure. By applying, a gas can be converted if the gas is at its critical temperature. It should be at its critical temperature. Otherwise, you cannot liquefy the gas. Hence, this can be a minimum pressure at which a gas is liquefied. I can say by which a gas is liquefied at its critical temperature. You can even say one mole of a gas. Gas is liquefied at its critical temperature. The relation for critical pressure is given by A by 27 B square. which is related to its mainly on volume correction factor and pressure correction factor, AB and A and B. 27 by A by 27 B square. Along with that, you will learn critical volume. V suffix C. Now you have to answer, students. Critical volume. Meghana? Critical volume. Define critical volume. Meghana? Define critical volume. Okay, can you say what is critical volume? Volume of, it's one mole of a gas occupied at its critical temperature and critical pressure. Volume of one mole of a gas at its critical temperature and critical pressure. That is called as critical volume. Whereas critical volume, which is given by VC, is 3B, 3 times B. I want the relation of PC VC divided by R into TC. Substitute those values and give me the relation. Everyone, try the relation of P C into VC divided by R into TC. Those values, substitute the values. Don't take the value of R. Anyhow, there is R which gets cancelled. Give me the ratio. Are you trying, students? As if.
Ma'am, it's not visible again. It's not visible, ma'am.
Yeah, just a minute. Can't see now?
Yeah.
I want the ratio of PC into VC by R into TC.
3/8.
Okay, right. Others, have you got the ratio? By applying these values, you get it as 3/8. Good. Right? There is one more point to be discussed, that is regarding the Joule-Thomson effect. Joule-Thomson effect. Let us assume an experiment where in a container which has two chambers separated by a layer which has jet holes. What is jet hole? A small hole which allows the diffusion of gas. Here there is a piston applied on both sides. The piston on the left hand side helps to increase the pressure. So it is the addition of applying the pressure from the left side, whereas this piston is pressure is decreased. Pressure is released from this side. Okay, there are two options. One side pressure is applied, the other side pressure is released. Such that if P1 is the pressure of first chamber and P2 is the pressure of second chamber, P1 is always greater than P2, correct? Because on the P1 side, pressure is applied, at the P2 side, pressure is released. This vessel should be an isolated one and insulated. So this is the insulation. Is an insulated vessel. And the system is isolated. Okay. The process which is done is under adiabatic condition. What is adiabatic condition? For which heat change is zero. There is no heat change. So this is a setup of experiment, right? There are two chambers in a vessel. First chamber is at pressure P1 and second chamber is at P2. Such that P1 is greater than P2, where we have an option of putting pressure on the first chamber and releasing pressure on the second chamber. The whole process is done at delta H equal to zero, hence called as adiabatic process. Therefore, this is an adiabatic expansion, isn't it? Why expansion? The gas from the first chamber is allowed to diffuse through a jet hole to a chamber where pressure is less. That is why it is getting expanded. The gas is getting expanded. And during this, if temperature is T1 and T2 of the first and second chamber, you will find two observations. During this process, you will find two observations based on the nature of gas. Either T1 is greater than T2 or T1 is smaller than T2. What if T1 for a given gas is more than T2. The gas gets cooled down or heated up. The gas is diffusing from chamber 1 to chamber 2, during which T1 is greater than T2. What would happen? Gas will cool down or get heated up. Cool down, right? This indicates gas is getting cooled down. And now, this effect is called as a positive Joule-Thomson effect. During the process, if the gas gets cooled down, then you call it as positive Joule-Thomson effect. What about this? When the gas flows from or diffuses from first chamber to second chamber, if the temperature increases, T2 is more, gas gets heated up. Here the gas is heated up. Now the process is called as negative Joule-Thomson effect. Anything may happen to the gas based on its nature. The gas may get cooled down or the gas may get heated up. Okay, and this effect depends on a particular temperature called as inversion temperature. Inversion temperature, whether the gas gets cooled up or gets heated up, depends on the inversion temperature. It's inversion temperature. Got it? Hence, it is based on the nature of the gas. Each gas has its own characteristic inversion temperature. Now, what is this inversion temperature? As I said, each gas has its characteristic inversion temperature. Above inversion temperature, if I say Ti is the inversion temperature, above inversion temperature, the gas gets heated up. That means it shows a negative Joule-Thomson effect. And below this temperature, the gas gets cooled down, which means it shows a positive Joule-Thomson effect. Is this clear? Students, is this clear? Hence, what is the Joule-Thomson effect? How to define Joule-Thomson effect? It is an adiabatic expansion of a gas through a jet hole. It is the adiabatic expansion of a gas through a jet hole, during which there are two observations. Either the gas cooled down, then you call it as positive Joule-Thomson effect, or gas heated up, then called as negative Joule-Thomson effect. Noted? Have you all noted it? Note the experiment setup and these observations. And inversion temperature. What is inversion temperature? It is a characteristic temperature of a gas above which gas gets heated up, shows negative Joule-Thomson effect. below which it gets cooled down shows positive Joule-Thomson effect. Have you all noted, students? Let me give you one question. A certain gas has inversion temperature, which is minus 80 degrees Celsius. Inversion temperature of a gas is minus, write the question. Inversion temperature of a gas is minus 80 degrees Celsius. When does the gas gets cooled down? Options. I've given four options. When does the gas gets cooled down? This is the question. Inversion temperature is given, minus 80 degrees Celsius. Three options are given. When does the gas gets cooled down? Anyone can answer. Students, anyone can answer. Anyone is ready with answer?
Is 193 Kelvin.
193 Kelvin. One answer has come as 193 Kelvin. Others also can respond. We'll check the right answer later. I've got one answer as option B. Any other answers? I'm not telling it is the final answer. We'll check as I get the answers. One option has come as B. Others can answer. Any other answers? Yes, Darshan, not it. What is the Kelvin temperature here? You must add 273, right? How much is the Kelvin temperature? How much is the Kelvin temperature? Minus 80 degrees equal to? This is equal to how much? 193 Kelvin, right? So in Kelvin, inversion temperature itself is 193 Kelvin. What is the question? When does the gas get cooled down? According to the statement here, below the inversion temperature, the gas gets cooled down. Now we have to check which is the temperature which comes below 193 Kelvin. It is 163, right? So which should be the answer? B is wrong. Answer is C. Understood? Is this clear, students? Inversion temperature is one. Below which, when the gas is subjected to Joule-Thomson effect, gets cooled down. You just write the meaning of inversion temperature. Statement for inversion temperature. It is a temperature. It is a characteristic temperature of a gas. It is a characteristic temperature of a gas. Above which, when the gas is subjected to Joule-Thomson effect, gets heated up, which is a negative Joule-Thomson effect, and below which it gets cooled down, that is positive Joule-Thomson effect. Hope this point is clear. Hence, by knowing the inversion temperature, one can decide whether the gas is undergoing cooling or heating. Right? You might have seen the application of this Joule-Thomson effect in your daily life. Can you just suggest? Yes, in AC, refrigerator, condenser is there, right? Those have the gases, different gases, which produce Joule-Thomson effect. Hence, for this, what is important to show cooling effect? In order to cool, gas to be easily liquefiable. Easily liquefiable gases show cooling. Here, I can tell you one more point. Hydrogen and helium, if subjected to Joule-Thomson effect, what would be the expected effect, positive or negative? Students, you can answer. hydrogen or helium when subjected to Joule Thomson effect, whether they'll show cooling effect or heating effect. Heating, right? It should be negative. Why? They have very weak van der Waals force. Those are not that easy to liquefy. That is why they show always negative Joule Thomson effect. Note down this point. Hydrogen and helium, due to their weak van der Waals force, always show negative Joule Thomson effect. That is, always get heated up during Joule Thomson effect. This is the reason why in refrigerator or AC, which gas is preferred? Which gas is preferred? Which is the gas used in AC or refrigerators, condensers? CFC was used, right? Yes, yes. CFC was used, but due to its toxic effect to the stratosphere, nowadays it has been replaced. CFC is getting banned in many of the countries, correct? Therefore, chlorofluorocarbon is replaced by fluoro derivative of CFC. Instead of chlorine, is a toxic element in that. Therefore, chlorine is replaced by fluorine derivatives. But still, why these type of compounds are used? Why was CFC used before in the AC condenser? Yes, they have strong van der Waals force due to its high molar mass. And these are the gases which usually show which effect? Cooling or heating? Preferably cooling effect. Is this clear, students? With this, I have completed the theory topic of this chapter. We will proceed with some of the numericals on this chapter or some concept-based questions. Any doubts, students, till here?
Ma'am, you are not explaining dipole-dipole force, dipole-induced force.
Force of attraction, van der Waals force you want to know? Okay, we will explain that. Van der Waals force. Different types of van der Waals force. Which are the types? Dipole, force of attraction, dipole, induced dipole, force of attraction, and the third one is induced. Induced dipole force of attraction. Induced dipoles. This induced dipole is also called as the London force of attraction. London's force. Now, what is dipole force of attraction? In this case, let us assume HCl, hydrogen chloride, H plus and Cl minus. Neighboring HCl, the electron cloud of chloride will have a force of attraction towards H plus, and this is called as dipole, because HCl is one dipole, another HCl is another dipole. It is a force of attraction, van der Waals force of attraction between two dipoles, then we call it as dipole type of force of attraction. Correct? Understood. Dipole induced dipole. What it will be? Dipole induced dipole. Any idea? Dipole induced dipole. Any idea? Assume you have HI, hydrogen iodide. hydrogen iodide, and there is iodine. What is iodine molecule? It is a non-polar. This is a polar molecule. Here I have considered both polar molecules. Both are polar molecules. In this case, one is polar molecule, HI. The other one is non-polar. Non-polar molecule. Okay. This H has positive charge, I has negative charge. Now the electron cloud of this I, makes this I to shift its electron to this side, such that this molecule tends to be H, I plus and I minus. Otherwise, iodine as a molecule is without dipole. It is a non-polar molecule. But as a polar molecule is nearby this, this polar molecule has induced a dipole on a non-polar molecule. This type of bond is called as dipole-induced dipole bond. Is it clear? A polar molecule is inducing dipole on a non-polar molecule. Then you get here again, there'll be a Van der Waals force of attraction created between I minus and I plus. Induced dipole. What will be the example for this? Induced dipole. Both molecules should be non-polar. There should be a non-polar molecule. Say XX. We'll take it as some AA. And another molecule is again AA. Both are non-polar. Now what would happen? When these molecules come close to each other, the electron cloud of one A, electron cloud of one of the A atoms, makes the electron cloud of this atom to shift towards the other side, making this as positive. Its electron will shift to the other A, making this as negative. This is positive, negative, and this is positive. Both are non-polar molecules, but each one is inducing polarity on each other. Then we call it as induced dipole, which is weakest among these three types. Could you follow the students? Is this clear? Any question? Shall I move to the questions or discussion of numericals and concept based questions? Shall we move? Or any of the points, any of the topics you want to discuss? You can respond, students. Do you want to discuss any more topic in this chapter or
Ion dipole.
Here also you have maybe the ion, like that is almost the same as dipole induced dipole, ion dipole. There is a negatively charged ion, say X minus, which is inducing polarity on a dipole molecule, that is H plus and Cl minus. This is positive and negative. An ion inducing polarity on this, because of which a bond is created here. Van der Waals bond is created here due to that attraction. This is called as ion dipole interaction. Clear? Anything else? Anything else, students? Then we move to the question answer discussion session. note down some of the questions. At STP, the order of RMS velocity of hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, HCl. At STP, the order of RMS velocity of these gases. As you solve, you tell me the answer. On what does RMS velocity depend? First of all, what is the formula of RMS velocity? Square root of 3 RT by M. At a given temperature, on what RMS velocity depends? Can we say it is proportional to 1 by square root of M? RMS velocity is proportional to 1 by square root of M, right? Therefore, molar mass, what is the molar mass of hydrogen? 2 oxygen, 32 nitrogen, 28 HCl, 36.5. Higher the molar mass? Yes, good. Hydrogen has highest. Next will be nitrogen. Then comes oxygen. Least is HCl. As molar mass and RMS velocity are inversely proportional. Good. Right, next question. Average kinetic energy of one molecule of ideal gas. At 25 degrees Celsius is, calculate and tell me the answer. Average kinetic energy of one molecule of an ideal gas at 25 degrees Celsius. Hope you have made the list of formulae, students. Have you done the list of formulae? Formula list? It should be complete. If that is ready with your hand, you can easily find out the formula, whichever is relevant for the given question. Then you can easily work. Kinetic energy formula, what is kinetic energy formula? 3 by 2 RT, that is for 1 mole. This can be KT, 2 right?
KBT.
Yes. Where the Boltzmann constant is used. That will be 2 by 3 into 1.38 10 raised to minus 23 into 25 degrees Celsius, 298 Kelvin.
6.17 into 10 to the power minus 21.
10 raised to minus 21. Good. That is in joules, right? Joules. This Boltzmann constant is joules per Kelvin into Kelvin temperature. Together it gives answer in joules. Right, good. Next question. Which of the following pairs of gases diffuse through a small jet hole with the same rate of diffusion at a given temperature and pressure? options are four options are given. Find out the answer. Which among these diffuses through a jet hole with same rate of diffusion? Your rate of diffusion depends on what? On what relation you are going to find? Rate of diffusion is? Yes. Inversely proportional to molar mass. So you can say depends on molar mass. In order to have same rate of diffusion, both should have same molar mass. Hence find molar mass of all the given gases. NO.
Option D.
14 plus 16. Yeah. Option? Fine. We will check the molar mass of each gases. NO. 14 plus 16 makes 30. This is 12 plus 16 makes 28. NO2, 32 plus 14, how much? 46, right? This will have 44, isn't it? Then here, ammonia, nitrogen, 14 plus 3, 17. Phosphorus, how much? What is the atomic mass of phosphorus? It is previous to sulfur, right? 31. 31 plus 3, 34. Here, 30, 24 plus 6, 30. So option D has two gases with the same molar mass, which means they have same rate of diffusion. Hence, right option is D. Next. Van der Waal constant for oxygen, nitrogen, ammonia and methane are given. The values are given as 1.36, 1.39, 4.17, 2.25. It is in liter, square, atmosphere, mole, power minus 2 unit. Which gas is easily liquefied? Identify the gas which is easily liquefied. Answer is ammonia. Why? Yes. What is given here? The value of A, van der Waal constant A is given. Higher the van der Waal constant, easier is the liquefaction. Isn't it? Ease of liquefaction even you can find based on van der Waal force. If values of A or TC, such data are not given, you can directly find based on the strength of van der Waal force. Okay. Van der Waal force in turn depends on what? How do you identify that this molecule has larger or weaker van der Waal force? How do you identify? Depends on what? How to decide? By seeing the molecule, one cannot say this molecule has strong van der Waal force or weak van der Waal force, right? How do you decide? It based on what? Molar mass. Higher the molar mass, stronger is the van der Waal force. Higher the molar mass, stronger is the van der Waal force. There are many other factors. This is one among them. Molar mass is one among the factors which decides strength of van der Waal force. Hence, in case in this question, if the values of A is not given, how do you identify which is easily liquefied? Answer has to be ammonia only. Depending on molar mass. Now you count the molar mass. Molar mass of oxygen. Count the molar mass and say. My question is, if the same statement is given without this temperature, without this values of A, how do you identify the answer? Answer should be ammonia itself. Molar mass of oxygen, nitrogen, ammonia. That is the molar mass. Then how do you decide that ammonia is? Students, you can answer. Anyone can answer? Did you follow my question?
Oxygen.
You mean to say oxygen is easily liquefiable? Huh? I said just try to understand the question. As this question has the value of A, you could easily find easily liquefiable gases, ammonia. Even if the value of A is not given, what should be your answer? If value of A is not given, saying that I don't know A, can I change the answer? Can I change the answer? This is a fact, right? Ammonia among them easily liquefied is a fact. Without knowing the value of A, can I change the answer that no, it is not ammonia, it is oxygen? Understood? The answer is ammonia itself. Answer has to be ammonia itself. Whether I know the value of A or I do not know the value of A, answer is ammonia itself. How do you decide? In case in the question, in the paper, you don't have the value of A, they'll ask you to find which gas is easily liquefiable. The value of A, value of TC, nothing is given. Just 2-3 gases will be given. You'll be asked how to identify. This is my question. Someone said then answer should be oxygen. No, you cannot change the answer because now we know already, right? By seeing the value of A, we already know that answer is ammonia. Now you cannot change the answer. But if these values are not there in the question, then how do you decide the answer as ammonia? Finally, you have to get the answer as ammonia.
Atomic number.
Huh? Yes, atomic pardon?
Number. Atomic number.
Atomic number. Atomic Huh?
Interatomic interaction.
Interatomic? Interaction, that is what I'm talking about, van der Waals force, right? You have to decide a van der Waals force, whichever has stronger van der Waals force, that will be easily liquefied, isn't it? And I gave you an easy method of understanding the strength of van der Waals force based on molar mass. Now, why the answer is ammonia? If you see the order of molar mass, you will come to the conclusion that it is oxygen. But answer is not oxygen. This is what I'm saying. What would happen when gas is converted into liquid? Or when does a gas is converted into liquid? When does a gas is converted into liquid? High pressure, low temperature. When the gas molecules are compressed, right? Molecules should come close and they get compressed. Then they get converted into liquid state, correct? Then what would happen to the force of attraction between them? Increases. Which force of attraction? It is a sort of physical force of attraction, isn't it? There are two main type of force of attractions, chemical force and physical force, or chemical bond and physical bond. Which all are chemical bond? Ionic bond, covalent bond, coordinate bond, metallic bond. These all are chemical bonds. And which are the physical bonds? Van der Waals. And one more, which is another kind of physical bond. Students, you can respond, which is another kind of physical bond. Or what is the difference between chemical and physical bond? Chemical bond involves electron interaction. Chemical bond involves electron interaction, like ionic bond, coordinate bond, covalent bond, metallic bond. These all are formed by the interaction of electrons. Either transfer of electrons or sharing of electrons, in a way, interaction of electrons. Physical bond do not involve interaction of electrons. Okay, there is just a force of attraction, which is physical force. Van der Waals force is one among them. There is one more important physical force, hydrogen bond. Hydrogen bond is another important physical force of attraction. Which is stronger? Hydrogen and van der Waals force. Which is stronger? Hydrogen bond is stronger than van der Waals force. Okay. Now go to the example. Why is water in the liquid form? Why it is not in the gaseous state? Due to hydrogen bond. Correct. So gaseous water, when gets converted into liquid water, what would happen in that? Hydrogen bond forms, right? More and more hydrogen bond forms, so that molecules are brought close to each other. Therefore, gaseous water from gaseous state gets converted into liquid state. Fine. There are certain molecules where only van der Waals force exists, but there are certain molecules where hydrogen bond is also possible. Therefore, when you talk about the liquefaction of gas, it is not the only van der Waals force you'll concentrate. You have to see even on hydrogen bond. Two points to be kept in mind. Got it? Now, to decide van der Waals force, I said you the molar mass. You can use that. But to decide hydrogen bond, what should be there in the molecule? You must know whether the given molecule can form hydrogen bond or not. Now, can you answer this question? Why ammonia is answer among them? Yes.
Hydrogen bond.
Yes, good. Ammonia is capable of forming hydrogen bond, which is stronger than van der Waals force. Hydrogen bond is stronger than van der Waals force. Therefore, by applying pressure at low temperature on ammonia, you can easily liquefy it because it is capable of forming hydrogen bond. So what is the conclusion of this answer? When such series is given in order to identify which is easily liquefiable, you should be able
Voice
to find...
Voice is not clear, ma'am.
Not clear. Can you hear now? You can hear? When the question comes where you have to identify the molecules which is easily liquefiable, you have to see two factors. Not only van der Waals force, you have to see either even hydrogen bond formation. If there is any molecule which can easily form hydrogen bond, you must opt that first. Then comes rest of the molecules. Clear? So ammonia is answer here, right? Okay, we'll continue the next class with few more questions. We'll solve few more questions in the next class. Till then, have a good day.